Hello and welcome to Single Login, the Interactive Lab. This session will describe the Jamf Pro side of getting Single Login added to Jamf Setup and will help you get through the Interactive Lab part. My name is Tim Knox and I'm the Senior Consulting Engineer for Industry Solutions at Jamf. My job here is to work with customers in industries like airlines, healthcare, retail, manufacturing, and pretty much any named industry that we're focused on, and try to find the places where Jamf can help smooth out deployments and work with our product team to amplify the voices of our customers for their specific needs. One of those needs was single sign-on for setup. We've been talking about it for a while now, and we have something out in the wild that our customers have been experimenting with since late June of this year. Please go to the link here for the interactive lab part of the presentation. This video is only half the talk. Going to that link will be a great way to try out what I'll be talking about today, and I urge everyone to head over there and follow along with me or follow up after and give it a go. So if you've been to any other single login sessions at JNUC, you've probably seen this slide and you've probably heard me present it, but let's take a little bit of a deeper dive with an eye towards what you'll be doing today in getting it set up for your environment. The whole goal with single sign-on for setup is to add a auth before making your role selection. If you remember the original version of setup, it was you could just make any role selection you wanted to make, and then it would present the right apps and restrictions based on that selection. But we needed a way to prove you are who you say you are. So we built with Azure, the single sign-on extension for Apple, and Apple's native single sign-on config profile, which we'll go into a little bit later, a sign-in screen before those role selections are seen. So you could be picking up a device, tap setup, log in with your cloud IDP, or if you want to, you can actually set a device level passcode at the very beginning as well. That's optional. We can talk about that a little bit later, but it really does give you the ability to have a device almost completely locked down, ready to be signed in, and then once you're signed in, release the restrictions and release the apps to allow you to do whatever use case you're looking to do for that role. And it uses that, as I said, the Apple Enterprise SSO support, and any apps that support it, and this is really important, can accept that single sign-on token and sign you in to those apps as well. But we need those app partners to start building that into their apps. We have a few. We'd love to have more. We'd love to have all the apps support it. And if you are a developer, take a look at our single sign-on for setup developer talk we did, where we actually talk about how to add that to your apps. At the end, you would tap reset, and then that would log you out of the apps and log you out of the device and get you set back into that null state, which we're going to talk a lot about today, ready for that next sign-in. But you're here for the interactive lab. Again, please go to that website, click along with us, and experiment with our own little sandbox and see how you can get it to work. Let's get started. First thing you need to do is make an extension attribute. This is an empty inventory field that you'll use to populate your choices. As we move through this presentation, you'll see my actual production Jamf Pro server that I've been using to demo and test things for about the last 5 years, and I've learned a lot about keeping things simple. Navigate to the gear in the upper right corner of the screen to get to settings, click on Device Manager, or scroll to the bottom and select Extension Attribute. Be sure you're in device management and not in computer management for this. For example, I prefer to use something like Jamf Setup Choice for my EA name, so that when I use it as a criteria in my smart groups, it makes a sentence. Jamf setup choice is store associate. Keep it as a string for the data type, and then decide where you want the EA to show up in your inventory record. I personally prefer to keep those in extension attributes, but if you would prefer to put it in users and locations, for example, it won't affect the workflow. The next thing would be to build your smart groups, so we have the ability to scope the things that we build. There are a few important parts to this. I like to be as obvious as possible when it comes to labeling my smart group so I can keep all my thoughts straight. The JNUC 21 install here smart group is where I would install all my apps and global config profiles. This has worked for me and my teeny tiny little fleet of demo devices, but just remember to label things clearly. I have also found it to be very useful to create a null group. Taking a look inside, you'll see that I have two criteria set. The second one is pretty obvious. There's no selection made in Jamf Setup, so the EA is blank. And I can use that to my advantage by setting a pre-logged in state. Maybe I have everything hidden except for setup so that you have to log in with your Azure creds in order to get access to the apps behind it. But this means I better stick another criteria on there so I'm not impacting my entire fleet that doesn't have setup on it and no way of inputting a value into that blank extension attribute. I use enrollment method, which is my favorite one. Looking at another selection here, let's see an example of what it would look like when you actually make a selection. You can start to see the utility the way we created the EA. JAMP setup choice is store associate. You can even click over to automated management tab and put a different wallpaper in each smart group to clearly indicate a change has been made. Now let's take a look at one that has a device in it already. JAMP setup choice is nurse. You can click on the view option and then into the device record. I've used user 3 logged in currently. And if you look at the EA section, well, we're gonna look at this first. Yeah, so you've got user 3 logged in. And if you look at the EA section, you'll see that nurse is selected. This could be an important troubleshooting step if there's ever any trouble. In the past, I've created a troubleshooting smart group that is an exclusion for all these restrictions. And I can change that EA manually to release all the apps or force an uninstall reinstall of the apps as a way to see what might be going wrong. In fact, you could put an I'm working on it wallpaper in the smart group so that when you flip that value to your troubleshooting value, the apps are released, the restrictions are gone, and the wallpaper indicates that it's in maintenance mode. Now, it does seem like a small thing, but setting a wallpaper based on the selection can be pretty huge. It shows the user something has changed after logging in, even if there isn't a visible change to the apps that are deployed. It can also be really helpful for devices that are found without a user attached to them. You can not only put nurse device on the lock screen as a wallpaper, but you could also deploy a lock screen message that could contain important information about who wandered away from their iPhone. The next thing you'll want to get set up is your setup app. You'll get this from the App Store, like always, and populate the app config section with your customized XML. I'll get into this in the video in a moment, but the big thing to note here is that there are two fields you need to get from your Azure admin. Registering setup in Azure will give you those values, and you can plop them right in there in those two empty fields. Following the instructions in the JAMP setup guide, you'll be walked through the steps of assigning a redirect URI, grabbing the application ID, grabbing the tenant or directory ID, and optionally, creating roles for your users to get assigned when they log in. If your admin isn't seeing them, we found that you may need to make sure they're using the mobile native URI and not the web URI. We've had a few people make that really easy mistake to make, and that would be the first place I would look. These steps are not covered in the interactive lab section. So if you're in there currently, just know that this part would be done by your Azure admin. If that's also you, the instructions are out on the website and it should be a fairly trivial process to register the app and then input that URI to get those values to put into Jamf Pro. Now there's a bunch of this in the interactive part, but I'll go into a little bit more detail here. This part here, should be the same for every installation across every instance. We get the OAuth code, the reinstall code, the name of your Jamf Pro server automatically with these keys, so you shouldn't need to change anything here. If you have a legacy version of Jamf Setup running, you should update these keys to make sure you're using OAuth for auth and not an API account like we had in the past. Test it first. Now, this is where things get really different. As I said before, you'll need to get these values from your Azure admin. The act of registering this app will give you those values, just like we talked about. And this is always the most difficult part of getting the whole workflow working. You do need to work with your Azure admin to get the app registered and get these numbers from them. The process isn't complicated, but it is a step we did not have to take before. This is a one-time thing for them. So once you have those populated and set up and reset, you're in business. Now, down here, you can see the EA that we created before, the Jamf Setup Choice EA. It doesn't matter if you have an array set here or not. I have one, so you can see some choices. If I log into a setup with no role defined in Azure, I would see whatever choices I have listed here. So making a bogus role or a not authorized role in Azure would be a way to prevent staff members with valid Azure accounts from accessing devices you don't want them to. Do you see the key that says require passcode? This is actually pretty slick. If you set this to true, you'll be prompted to make a device level passcode before being allowed to move into the sign-in process. This will also get cleared when you log out. It's a really clever way to make it so that each individual user has their own personalized access to the device per shift. It even does biometrics, so you can have Face ID and Touch ID set and cleared per shift. Really cool stuff. And of course, below all that is branding. You can change the words on the buttons, the colors, the images across the tops or the sides, and a few other things. Very good for making it feel like it's coming from your company and not from a third party. Okay, moving on to reset. Same with setup. These keys up here will be the same across all of your installs. It should look exactly like setup. This key is new with single login and is pretty important. Set to true like we have here, it will empty the EA value, end the SSO session, and clear the passcode if you have one set. Setting it to false will wipe the device, so be careful. Again, just like with setup, this section will be very specific for your company. You can use the exact same block of text from setup. You don't need to get anything new or register reset or anything. Just copy and paste and it should be fine. This is also a new key string pair. You need to let reset know which EA to clear on logout so that you can get put back into that null state. And same with setup, here's your branding section. Reset is a little simpler to set up than setup, and much of what you put into one can just be copied straight into the other. The last piece of the puzzle is Authenticator. As of this recording, it's required for Authenticator to be placed in shared mode. Now, I can't speak for the future state of Microsoft, but currently you would place this XML in Authenticator, and once you have it deployed, you would sign in with your Azure Cloud Device Manager account on the device to put it in shared mode. If Authenticator doesn't look like this, setup won't work. Again, this is the current state as of this recording, so please be sure to check the most current install guide to make sure nothing has changed. Now here's where it gets really fun, where we start to truly shape what happens after a user logs in. All of these should match pretty closely to the smart groups you made. If you look at the JNUC 21 pilot profile, it's scoped to the JNUC 21 pilot smart group. Keeping things consistent is vital to success. And remember what I said about using install here as a place to install global profiles. Home screen layout should be one of those. I cannot stress enough how important it is to have one and only one of these scoped to your setup fleet. Do not try to get clever and use a different role or layout per role. There are race conditions that can crop up and cause you no end of grief. It can mean that you might have to move more than four apps into your dock, and that's okay. We'll only be revealing them in the restrictions profile, and that should not be attached to this one. It could mean you have a pretty complicated layout, like I have here, but it means you can scope this to everyone and use the roles to hide and unhide them. A little forethought here will save you a huge headache down the road. Now, taking a look at the single sign-on extension payload, another one that can be scoped to the global smart group, there's one thing to remember. As we scroll down here, we're going to come across one thing that's labeled single sign-on. It's not that one. You want that one. That's the one you're looking for. Not that one, that one. We see a sample payload here for single sign-on extension. In this case, we define the extension identifier, which is the bundle ID of the app who will be handling the authentications. Sign-in type is defined as redirect to redirect requests set to the URL sign-in page to the identity provider. In this case, we intercept the standard public US endpoints for Azure. In the custom configuration area, we could define attributes specific to the identity provider, or we can define a list of application bundle IDs, which should be forced to redirect requests. In this sample, we can see the application with the bundle ID Aaron Maxim demo kit will be forced into the SSO. So let's look at a nurse config profile that is scoped to the nurse smart group. It's actually quite small in my example, but you could add more to this group like custom restrictions or network access. Way down at the bottom in the app restriction part, we have it set to only some apps allowed. And we've listed the apps we want visible to the nurse. The apps are already installed by scoping them to the install here group, and they're already in the proper layout because they're in the global home screen layout. But this will unhide the apps that have been hidden by the null group since the device is no longer in the null group. But let's take a look at that null group. Way more restrictive because we don't want anything visible before the user logs in. You do have to make Authenticator available on the device. This is important, but you can put it in a folder on the second page. It just has to be there. All right, let's put it all together here. taking a look at this video here of the actual thing in place, you can see I've got Authenticator in the second page. I've got my home screen layout assigned to everybody. And when I open setup, it's being redirected to that Azure login. Now I'm going to log in with user one that has a role assigned to them as nurse in Azure. So as I auth into Azure, Azure goes, I know who you are. And we're going to take that nurse field and put it in Jamf setup choice. Once it's in Jamf setup choice, it's going to come out of the null group. It's going to go into the Jamf setup choice is nurse group, which will then put it in that config profile we looked at, which will then reveal the apps that we're looking for and change the wallpaper to indicate that there's been a significant change. Just like that. And if I open the demo kit, oh, we're going to look at this one more time. You can see Authenticator is still there. Everything's all the same. Same home screen layout. We haven't changed anything. But if I open single sign-on demo kit, I'm now signed in because it's passed that on because I had that in that config profile to respect the redirect. And when I sign out, it's going to clear the extension attribute, which will make that field empty, which will put it back in the null group. It will clear the single sign-on token. It will change the wallpaper back and put us back in that null state, that super restrictive state in that null smart group, waiting for the next person to come in, sign in with whatever it is they have, either select a role or have that role assigned, which will then put it in that group again, which will then trigger all that automation, and you're off to the races. Again, you won't be doing any of the Azure part in the lab since we're focused on the Jamf side, but remember that all they need to do is register the app and get that redirect URI in place and get those two bits of information for you. Optionally, they could add that role to the security group or to the individual to get that part automated, but that isn't necessary to get it working in your environment. Remember to keep things as simple as possible, clear naming conventions. I know you all know that, but I have to say it because I've worked with so many people. And when I see a list of iPads across everybody's fleet and it's all called the same, it makes my poor heart break. So just make sure you're making good, clear naming conventions so that you can have a good, clear, scalable Jamf Pro instance and everything will work all nicely. I want to thank everybody very much for listening today and getting your hands on that lab. Remember to have some fun out there. Do go there and try it out. It should be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to seeing what you all do with this. Thank you very much.